Amen. The gospel means good news. And the good news is that God has chosen to reveal himself in Jesus Christ. Paul bears witness of this in Colossians chapter 1, verse 15. The Son, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God. And in the past, we have said, if you want to know God and you want to know his heart, you look at Jesus. Jesus, the firstborn over all creation. That's a reference to resurrection. Jesus is the prototype in his resurrected body of what you and I will one day look forward to and one day be. Jesus is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Now notice this in verse 18. And he is the head of this body. And what body is that? That's not his resurrected body. It's the church. And he is the head of the body, the church. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Jesus. And through Jesus, reconciled to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Now, this is a powerful verse. We understand that when Christ died on the cross, not only did he take away our sins, but something else took place at resurrection. When he came out of the tomb, it was signifying something new. He was bringing together and fulfilling a new humanity, infusing his life, his righteousness, to those that follow him. And those that follow him are called his church, also known in Scripture as ecclesia. Now, this ecclesia word was derived from the Greek language. It was actually borrowed by these early Christians from the Romans. When a Roman emperor would go off on his conquests and he would attack certain places, he would come home bearing good news. Now, before he got home, he would have a messenger bring his message of his conquests. Those people that supported this Roman official would have a hub where they would meet. These people that would follow this Roman leader were called followers of this Roman leader. At this area where they would meet, it was called an ecclesia, a congregation of people called out to follow this leader. Now, the early Christians borrowed that terminology, and they used the word ecclesia to define themselves. They were not following Rome or Caesar, but they were followers of Jesus. And they were disciples or evangelicals or evangelians bringing this message of Jesus, which was hope and reconciliation. The language that Paul uses is the church. This called out assembly, the ecclesia, those called out to follow Christ. Now, the church is Christ's body. This is where reconciliation and healing takes place. In community. Now let's read this in Ephesians chapter 3. God shows us how he is working through his church. Paul says this, I became a servant of this gospel, or good news, by the gift of God's grace given me through the working of his power. Although I am less than the least of all the Lord's people, this grace was given to me. Of course, we know Paul's story. He was a murderer. He persecuted the church, and we'll get to that in just a minute. And he says, I was commissioned to preach to the Gentiles the boundless riches of this mystery, which for ages past was kept hidden in God who created all things. Now note this. God's intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. What I'm trying to drive home today is this understanding. The Christian life was not meant to be lived alone. The Christian life, as we journey and band together, this is how God is revealed to the world. According to this text we just read, the Christian life is not an individual pursuit. It is a collective journey. It is vital to our well-being that we live connected. As I told you these stories, as I opened this teaching, each of these people that were struggling had someone right there with them. If it wasn't a family member, it was their church family. And that is so important in the day in which we live for us to understand. That is, as Christ followers, it is our job to be Jesus to the world. We are a called out community of people for this community. Knowing Christ and making Him known, again, is not an individual prospect. We must do this in community, which means, yes, we acknowledge who Christ is. We acknowledge our need of a Savior. Once we do that, Christ says, now I'm going to give you the motivation to be Jesus to the world. We do this in community. We were made to be connected. We find life when we are together. We also find purpose when we are connected. The point is this: the church represents God's ultimate purpose in history, and all Christians should find their life's purpose in the role of that ultimate purpose. The church is something that God empowered. This is why I have surrendered to be a pastor. For many years, I studied history, even taught history, and I realized that empires come and go. I understand politics is shifty. I understand there's not a lot of hope in that. And I was discouraged at first. And I thought, well, where do we turn? What do we do if we're going to change the world? And then it really hit home that the only place we find home, hope, and change is in the message of Jesus Christ. It's in this incredible gift that He gave to us on Calvary, saying, yes, this world is broken and torn. Even in your own DNA, you're broken down. But one day, it won't be like that. That's what resurrection talks about. As He comes out of the tomb, it's a picture of what we will be one day. The great resurrection. The Old Testament talks about that. Paul speaks of it. In the meantime, while we are alive, we are to partner with God as Jesus' disciples to do what Jesus did. To walk in the way of our Savior. If we don't understand that purpose, as humans, we try to fill that void with many other things. So, in reference to Ephesians, when the scripture says that the church's responsibility is to manifest the wisdom of God and make this known to the world, that means you and I, collectively, the church, has a purpose. We have a job to do. Here's how the manifold wisdom of God is made known by the church. First, is to discover Jesus. As people come into our community, as people rub shoulders with us, they should be able to realize that there's something different about our lives. And the scripture says we will be known by our love. The Bible says that Jesus went about doing many things, but He went about doing good. That's what He was known for. And as Christ followers, we should manifest that. We should shine forth what Christ imparted to us. And it takes a functioning body, corporate community, to know Christ fully. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16. I pray that out of your glorious riches, He may strengthen you with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in God's love, may have, now watch this, power together, as a group, as a corporate, as a collective group of God's people, you may have power together with all the Lord's people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses even understanding, the scripture says, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. So church, we have a mandate. We have a mission. Number one, it's to replicate and discover Christ. But number two, collectively, we have a second purpose. It's to display Jesus to the world. And again, it takes a functioning body coming together to display His fullness. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul wrote that Jesus isn't a mute idol. I don't know if you remember the story. Paul is journeying into pagan communities. He sees many of their pagan idols. And he says, oh, you have a God, an unknown God. And they had an effigy representing this unknown deity. And Paul used the culture and the language of his time. And he said, let me tell you about this unknown God that you supposedly worship. He says, Paul says, that this God doesn't need human hands. This God is powerful. He's the God of God. And he goes on to say this. about this God, how this God speaks. He speaks through His body. Verse 12, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body. Now this is a reference to a human body. We have hands, we have feet, they're all different, but they're vitally important, but they're still all one body. He goes on to say it is. So it is with Christ. For we are all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body. Whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is made up of one part, but of many. That's you and me. We have such different backgrounds. We have so much different influences on our life, and we're so different. And it's okay. Paul goes on to say on later that we come together in the unity of Christ. We have differences of opinion, and it's okay. And we must recognize that. But when we do come together as a church, we come together in the unity of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, which is love, we just read about earlier. Excuse me. Notice that Paul didn't say, so also is the church. Paul said, so it is with Christ. The important thing I want you to understand today is that when Christ resurrected, Scripture says He went to be with God. You know this in the story. The disciples are standing around looking. The angels speak to them and say, what are you looking for? But remember, Jesus said before that time, I'm coming back as something different, as the Holy Spirit. And I would submit to this idea that the reason why Jesus had to go away is because for the kingdom to be built and people to be reached with this good news, He said, you will do greater than I can do as one person. Because as this message goes off, and one of you reach one, and one of you reach another, and this thing spreads, that's how the kingdom would be built. I think, and I submit this idea, that if Jesus had stayed, He would have been a distraction. Because they said, well, here's the man that raised from the dead. Here's the man that walked on water. Here's the man that fed 5,000 people. Here's the man who was crucified and came out of the grave in 3 days. And everybody would have tried to get Him to endorse their product or their thing. And I think it's beautiful that the God of the universe would say, you know what? I'm going to use you. I'm going to come back and dwell in you. You will be my people. A called out people. An ecclesia. A church that really is my body. Now, I'm not saying that you and I are part of the Trinity, but we're part of Christ's body. It's beautiful. And as we come together with our differences, that's a good thing. Because you will reach people that I can't reach. And I can reach people that you may not be able to reach, and so forth. So remember, the church is the reassembling of Christ so that He might be made visible on earth. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said it very well when he said this. He said that the church is Christ existing as community. When people see this congregation, not this building, but when they see you and me, the church, they should see and sense something different. They should know automatically there's something different. And the difference is that we replicate Calvary quality love to them. As Christ hung on the cross, He says, Father, forgive them. As they spit, and as they pierced His side, and as they mocked, and as they beat Him, and as they scorned, He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. And I'm sure it moved the man on His side. And I'm sure it moved the Roman centurion that said, surely this is the Son of God. They noticed something in Jesus that they had never seen. What was it? Anger? No, we've all seen that. Critical spirit? I'm going to get you back? No. They saw, Father, forgive them. I'm giving my life because I love you. And when the church replicates this Calvary quality love, it's refreshing. And the message of Jesus Christ is to be cool water. The message of Jesus Christ is to be living bread. Things that bring life. Things that bring refreshment. Paul again articulates this in Acts chapter 9 as Luke records this. Jesus and His church are not two different things. They're one and the same. You know the persecution that Saul was bringing to Christ's church. And the Bible says this, "And Paul fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?'" He didn't say, "Why are you persecuting my church?" He said, "Why are you persecuting me?" This is after resurrection. And Paul, or Saul, speaks out, "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." So the church is the assembling of Jesus Christ. You and I have His life. He has imparted His righteousness to us. And those that have said yes to salvation, they have said, "Yes, I want you to be the Lord of my life." And you give up the reins of your life and let Him give you His life. He indwells you. He enlightens you with His Holy Spirit's presence. He helps you walk in truth. He gives you wisdom. And as we study Scripture and as we come together, He is manifested. So it saddens me when I hear people say, "If we could only see Jesus, I'd believe in Him." I've got a dear friend that I've been working and talking to for a long time, wrestling through some of his questions. And he said, "Todd, you know what? This would make it real easy for me to be a believer in your Jesus. And it'd make it real easy for me to become a Christian if I could just see Jesus." Kind of similar to what Thomas said. He said, if he could just show up, then I would believe. And it hurts me. It breaks my heart. And you know why? Because this young man was in religion from the time he was a little guy all the way through high school. He was in a Christian school. He went to a very large Christian church. And to this day, he's an agnostic. For a long time, he's an atheist. So we're getting somewhere. At least there's still a possibility in his mind. But he says, "I don't see Jesus." I said, "What about the congregations you've been in?" He goes, "Oh, you don't want to talk about that." I said, "What about your local ecclesia?" "I don't go. In fact, I find more," and then he goes on to tell, "more kindness in the social clubs that he joins." And it breaks my heart. Because the world is looking for love. And the ultimate expression of love is the cross. When God Himself said, "I am taking your place. I will take care of your sin debt." If we as a church, the body of Christ, could radiate this, my, how it could change lives. Remember, Jesus and His body, the church, they're one and the same. We are the church, you and me. We are to manifest Jesus. And when we come together, it should be refreshing. It should be a time of learning. It should be a time of encouraging. It should be a time of equipping and exhorting and walking together. So remember, you can't separate the head from the body. And Christ said, "I'm the head of this body." You can't separate the vine from the branches. You cannot separate the foundation from the temple. We also cannot separate the bridegroom from the bride. They're all one. And I hope you understand this today, that when you leave this building today, church isn't over. You are the church. Your ministry and your mission field starts outside this door. And may we always keep in mind, how is it that I can radiate Jesus Christ to this broken world? I'll close with this quote. Martin Luther said it many years ago, "Anyone who is to find Christ must first find His church." How could anyone know where Christ is and what faith is in Him unless they know where His believers are? The Bible says it this way, "How shall they hear without a preacher?" Yes, we teach the Word. Yes, we stand behind this lectern and we preach. But some of the best sermons are the life that we live. And again, who you work with, who you neighbor next to, who you journey with, you may be the only Jesus and the only Bible that they will ever read. They may never darken the door of this building, but they can bump up against Christ's church, and that's you and me. Will you pray with me?